Subscribe to Motoroids for the most in-depth and detailed car and bike reviews. Hit that bell icon and you will be notified before everyone else. Hey guys, welcome to Motoroids.com. My name is Amit Changani and this is the all-new Amaze Honda has reimagined for India. With the Amaze, Honda has gone back to the drawing board and they have put in a lot of research to figure out what the Indians really want. And it seems like they have really figured what they do, and I'll tell you why. Let's start off with the design up front first. And that very bold Honda grille with this flat cut nose is probably going to disturb a few of the purists amongst us, me included. Now, when I first saw this car at the Auto Expo, I saw that nose and I said to myself, well, this looks rather disproportionate. Guess what? A lot of people told me that I was wrong. Seems like the car was designed after a lot of research, and this apparently is what the Indian people want. And if you go and see the comments on our original YouTube Amaze launch video, you'll realize that people have actually liked the design of this car a lot. And it's ultimately the people, not me, who's going to buy this car. So let's try and break down why the Amaze looks so different and what's the philosophy behind it. Now, the research that Honda has done tells them that the Indian audience that buys into the sedan segment also somewhat wants some SUV-ish features. And it's very apparent with the advent of the crossover era. The roads are broken in the country, there are potholes, nobody mends them, and the car suspension has to go through a lot of abuse. So in that sense, Honda wanted to create a car that looked very solid and rugged from the bottom, still had a very sporty kind of a roofline to blend a rugged appearance with a sporty character. That nose, that butch appearance up front is a nod in that direction, and it tries to let you know that this car can take in its stride all the abuse that the Indian roads can throw at it. The front grille is what Honda likes calling the wing face, and this is something that the car shares with the Honda Civic as well as the new CR-V. The headlamps get this LED position light. The headlamps are all halogen lit and there is no LED lighting here for the main headlamp. It's very sculpted, it's very chiseled, it's very muscular, it's very brawny, and to me, even today, this car is a little disproportionate. However, once you move towards the side, it starts looking better and better. The key word here is tension. Honda wanted to create a very taut kind of a design, a very rugged kind of a design, especially at the bottom, and I think they have succeeded. The ground clearance here has been increased 5mm to 170mm now, and that should help this car go over bad surfaces even better. The wheels have been replaced. The 14-inch wheels on the previous version are now 15-inchers, and the alloys look rather smart. They are shot with 175 section Bridgestone rubber, and the grip from these tires is pretty good. As we figured during our test drive today, we took it to Nandi Hills and the car handled beautifully there. These ORVM mounted blinkers are also new and they look rather smart. You'd also get this smart entry system wherein if you have the key in your pocket, you can get in without having to press any buttons. Another important detail is the shark fin antenna, which replaces the old wire antenna and it adds to the sporty character of the car. It's at the rear where I think that the car looks the smartest. Those angular tail lamps which are somewhat shaped in a boomerang shape, they look very nice, and the angles and the cuts and the creases gel well with the sedan body style at the rear more than anywhere else of the car. Now this car has grown in terms of dimensions everywhere, and apart from the height where the car has gone down by about 5mm, it has increased its wheelbase and it's now almost the longest in the segment. Even the Dzire doesn't have such a long wheelbase. The wheelbase stands at 2470mm, and it has really enhanced the cabin space. In addition, the width is now 1695, which is quite wide, almost the widest in the segment again. Only the Dzire is wider. What also has increased is the boot space, which at 420 liters is now class leading and is bigger than the Dzire significantly. As you can see, there's a medium sized suitcase here, there's a big bag, and there's ample room for a lot of other stuff. However, the only thing is that it's a little too deep and the loading lip could have been a little lower for putting the stuff in and taking it out easily. You also get these parking sensors on the V variant, while the top of the line VX variants get a reverse parking camera. You also get this smart key, and if your car is locked, you don't need to unlock it as long as the key is in your pocket. You just have to walk close to the car and open it. Also, in order to lock it, you just have to press this button and walk away. You don't have to take the key out again. So in that sense, the new key adds more convenience. You can also use this button here to open the boot, which is a great convenience again. So in all, it's a rather unusual looking car. I cannot yet call it handsome. It still has to grow on me. But what I know for sure is the fact that it's been driven by research and not by whims. And this has been proven on Motoroid's YouTube channel itself by a lot of you. Let's get inside the car and see what all is new there as well. More than anywhere else, it's inside the cabin where a lot of thought, a lot of work has gone in. And the moment you get inside the new Honda Amaze's cabin, you'd realize that this is a totally different car. Honda has put in a lot of effort in making sure that the interior is high quality. It's made of soft to touch materials. It's not too cluttered. It's done in a subtle manner. There's not too many colors. And the way the colors have been matched looks very nice. To me personally, this is one of the nicest interiors in this class. And I'll tell you why. These materials here on the dashboard, they are very soft to touch. The finish on bits like this central AC panel is very nice. These satin silver inserts, they look very nice. And everything is fit to perfection. I don't see anything protruding out. There are absolutely no jagged edges. There are no sharp edges. The plastic has a very nice, beautiful quality about it. Everything is very well-rounded. It has a very nice leatherish kind of a finish to it. And in that sense, even the plastics have a very nice matte kind of a look to them. I don't see any shiny, dirty kind of a plastic in this cabin. And from a quality of materials perspective, I think Honda has done a fantastic job. I really like the colors they've chosen. For example, if you look at those door pulls, those satin grayish kind of door pulls, they look absolutely amazing. And that kind of a color to be chosen needs some taste. The piano black on the center console with this dull black, as well as the beige, it really makes the car feel very airy, very nice and very warm. I really like this cabin for what it is, and the quality has gone up several notches, and I need to congratulate Honda for that. Now, apart from that, a lot of new features have also been added. The center console is very slightly tilted towards the driver to allow easy access and to make it ergonomically correct. The buttons here are very nice to touch, and I really like the effort that Honda has put in to make sure that there's a very good quality feel about them. Even these dials have a very nice positive click to them, and this is something that you typically associate with expensive German cars, but Honda has managed to give us that here in this segment, and this is something that you really have to experience to understand what I'm talking about. The steering wheel here has also been redone, and it's nice and chunky to hold. I quite like the way it feels to the hand. You get this piano black inserts everywhere in the cabin, including the door panels, the area surrounding the drive selector knob on the dashboard, as well as on the center console. Another great feature that the car has, and not a lot of people have observed that, is that it leaves a lot of open area for your knee, and your knee would not foul with anything here on the panel, even if you're a tall person. And while that may not sound like much to you, a lot of people who face trouble with something fouling against their knee will find it very useful. You get a 12-volt power socket here. You also get a USB charging socket here. On the top-end variant, this is the V variant, on the top-end variant you have a touchscreen. And for that you get another USB socket here, which is 1.5 ampere. And through that you can connect to Android Auto as well as Apple CarPlay. And we are going to make you run through that touchscreen as well in a few minutes time. In the meantime, this one can run Bluetooth, it has radio, and it can also play your USB files. It has an aux in, and the sound quality on this system as well as on the touchscreen system is the same. There are four speakers, and it sounds quite nice as long as you are at mid to slightly high levels. If you go all the way up, the sound starts getting a little distorted, but at the mid levels, the sound has decent bass and it sounds quite nice. It's par for the course, and you won't have to replace the system if you choose to live with the stock system. The AC, by the way, chills very nicely. It comes with an auto AC, and Honda has put in special effort to make sure that the AC on this car is powerful. They have improved the AC as compared to the previous Amaze. And as we saw during the day, the AC was chilling very, very efficiently. The instrument console has also been completely revamped and gets these rather subtle white on black taco and speedometers with, again, a white on black digital multi-information display. It shows you everything that you want. On the left, you have the instantaneous fuel efficiency. On the right, you have the fuel gauge. You also get the gear that you have selected. You get ambient temperature, and you also get the average fuel efficiency, trip meters and odometers along with time. So you get everything that you want from your instrument console, and it has all the information that you need. You can turn the engine on or off using this push button, which again is a new feature. And the quality of the buttons, the quality of the materials everywhere is quite nice. You'll have a very nice, airy kind of feeling while sitting in this cabin. The seats are nice too, although they are not the best in the segment. There is nice bolstering here. I wish that there was a little bit more firmness to the seats. They are well padded, though we have experienced a couple of better seats in the segment, but there is absolutely nothing to complain about. It also gets this adjustable headrest, which is quite uniquely designed, and I quite like the way it is. And the seat is going to keep you comfortable even if you're going for a long journey. On the door panels, you see another example of the thought that has gone in, and you see that there is space for a big 1.5 liter water bottle here and then some, as well as there is some space here to put your wallet if you so wish. What also needs to be mentioned very clearly is the fact that Honda has taken care of little things that we Indians want, and this crevice here is very useful if you wish to put your cell phone there. You can also put your wallet there in addition, and you'll still have some space to spare for two cups. This may be a small thing to a lot of you, but if you use a car on a day-to-day basis, such open spaces really make a difference. And these are the kind of little things that they've done after doing the research, the extensive research that has led to making this car. And I can tell you that it really appeals to an average Indian car buyer like me. In addition to those two spaces, you also have some more space here where you probably can put your keys or maybe a small cell phone. But there is another space here, and you have a big bottle holder for the front or the rear passengers, whatever suits you. The one thing that I don't like about the cabin is this headliner. It looks rather flimsily built, although it's not going to go anywhere, nobody's going to touch it. But had this been a bit more sturdy, I would have liked that. So this is something that I can nitpick on. Apart from that, the steering can be adjusted only for height. It's not adjustable for reach, but that's par for the course. Even smaller buttons like this remote boot opener, the fuel lid opener, bonnet opener are built of good solid plastic. There is a feel of quality about them. Even if you look at these door sills, they are finished in a manner which is quite unlike a lot of other cars in this segment, and we quite like the way this whole thing appears when you sit inside the car. There is a sense of quality and good workmanship about the new Honda Amaze which totally impresses us, and from the driver's perspective, I think that the little things that they've done about the car are something that will appeal to a lot of Indians, and once you sit inside the car and take a test drive, you'll definitely appreciate the kind of effort that's been put into the car. For the automatic variant, there is a dead pedal to rest your left foot. However, such is not the case with the manual version. The car comes standard with twin airbags as well as ABS. And sitting here, I really feel that it's a big leap from what the car was before. And the quality of this would definitely make me recommend this to friends and family. And that can only be a compliment to Honda. So we told you all about the V variant, which is the second best variant. Now this one is the VX variant, which is the top of the line. And it comes with a touchscreen. As you can see, the interface is pretty simple. You can use a radio. The good thing is that it has a native navigation system as well. However, if you want to use it with Android Auto, that is also possible, and you will require a cable, and it has to go into this 1.5 ampere slot for you to connect. And as soon as you do that, you will be connected via Android Auto. So that's a neat feature to have, and Honda has provided that. Also, this 1.5 ampere USB in socket that you have here is not there on the V variant. This is only for the VX, especially to connect through Android Auto. Another great feature that you have here is cruise control, only on the top of the line VX variants, and this is not there on any other variant. Another good thing that you'll see about the manual versions is that it comes with this very nice rubber cover for the gear stick, and it looks very nice, goes very well with the interior. Now Honda claims that they have increased the cabin space to make it the segment leader. Is that really the case? Let's get to the back seat and figure out. Now with the increased wheelbase and having pushed the engine forward, optimized the driver's seating position and making a few other changes, Honda claims to have increased the leg room, the knee room, the head room and the shoulder room for the rear passenger by a substantial margin. And let's do some number crunching now to make you understand how much better this one is as compared to the previous generation Amaze. The shoulder room has improved by 45 mm. The headroom has improved by 10 mm. The overall width of the car has gone up by 14 mm. The leg room is up by a whopping 50 mm. The knee room is up by 40 mm. And although the headroom is supposed to have been increased, the overall height of the car has come down by 5 mm. So how does all of that change feel from the back seat? Well, the ingress and egress is pretty easy, so it would not be very difficult for old people to get in. These recesses in the back of the front seat enhances the knee room further, and as you can see, there is ample knee room here. I really like the amount of knee room this car has. The rear passenger also gets this 12 volt power socket, although the headroom is slightly less than what I would have ideally wanted. I'm comfortable here, my head is still not brushing, but if somebody is taller than say 5'11", his head may be brushing with the roof more than what he would find comfortable. You also get this armrest with twin cup holders, and the seats overall are very comfortable. Again, as I told you about the front, I wish that the padding was slightly firmer, but I'm not complaining. These are very comfortable seats. These can seat two very comfortably. Third in the middle would be a bit of a squeeze. The third passenger will also get a lap seat belt, not a proper 3-point seat belt. But from a comfort perspective, I think for average built people, the back seat of the Amaze is definitely more comfortable than what it was before. There's a lot more space, and these light colors really make the cabin feel very nice, spacious. The quality has gone up, and in that sense, you definitely feel a sense of comfort, which is a notch above the car that was in production before. The one thing that I didn't like, however, is the fact that these headrests are not adjustable. I really wish they were, but they are not. One good thing though is that all the seats are ISOFIX, and if you have a child in the family, it would not be a problem for you to mount another seat and make sure that the child is safe and secure. Finally, in the door panels, you have again space for a big 1.5 liter bottle, and that's again something that has come with a lot of market research, and we think that Honda has done a good job with the cabin. It's built reasonably well for the class. The quality of the plastics and materials is top notch, and I would not mind recommending this car to my friends and family after seeing all these upgrades. All in all, a big thumbs up to Honda for having improved the cabin in such a holistic manner. Now, in addition to all the changes that I mentioned, Honda has done a lot of work under the running board, and they have made sure that they have used a lot of sound deadening, improved the architecture of the monocoque, improved the architecture of the suspension, the underpinnings, everything, to make sure that the car doesn't make much noise, to make sure that NVH levels are much, much lower than the previous version. I have driven all the variants, and I can vouch for the fact that the sound insulation on this car is much, much better than the previous version. In fact, it's better than what's average for the segment, and the cabin is particularly quiet. There is very little wind noise, there is no road noise, there is no tire noise, and ambient noise is also very well controlled. So in that sense, Honda has done a lot of work, not just in things that are visible, but also in a lot of things which are invisible, and all of that can be felt when you're driving the car. This car comes with two engines and four variants in terms of the powertrain. So you have petrol, manual, and petrol automatic, which is a CVT, and you have a diesel manual and a diesel automatic, which again is a CVT, and we have driven all of them. So let's get behind the wheel of this one and figure out how well they drive. So we are driving the diesel engine. It's mated with the 5-speed manual transmission. There is also a CVT, but we are going to talk about later. Now, the power and the torque on the engine remains the same. It's 100 PS and 200 Newton meters of torque, which is segment best in terms of power. However, the Ford Aspire has a little more torque, about 19 Newton meter more, but in terms of power and performance, should not have anything to complain about with this one. The more important thing is that Honda says that they have reduced the NVH levels significantly from the engine, particularly because we can definitely feel that the ambient noise, the road noise, the wind noise, all of that has been definitely reduced. Has the engine noise also been reduced? Yes, it is reduced as compared to the previous version. However, if you compare it with the other cars in the segment, the noise is still slightly on the higher side, so there is still some scope for improvement. However, the amount of noise reduction on this car in terms of engine is laudable. Now, in terms of performance, this engine was always very, very tractable. So even when you are at 1000 RPM, it pulls along with some reassurance. After 1500 RPM, you have a lot of pull, and it spools up properly at 2000 RPM. So performance from this engine, from a day-to-day driving perspective, is not going to be a problem. You can drive it very easily within the city. You don't need to shift gears. And talking about the 5-speed manual transmission, the shifts are pretty slick. The gear knob feels nice to hold. It's a small gear knob, so it fits nicely into the hand. It's very well finished, and there are short throws, so you feel like shifting on this car. So shifting gears on this car is quite a joyful exercise. It's not the smoothest or the slickest, although it's not bad either. There is no rubberiness to it. However, there is a wee bit of notchiness to it, which could probably have been avoided. That fluidity, that slick click feel is missing. However, this is still a decent gearbox. We really think that for this segment, this is par for the course. There is nothing to whine or complain about. All in all, this engine with its fuel efficiency, which by the way is 27.4 kilometers to the liter, is pretty good, next only to the Desire. Is pretty good, and on the average efficiency meter also, we are consistently getting about 17 to 18 kilometers to the liter. So in the real world also, they should deliver you a very good fuel efficiency. So in terms of performance, in terms of tractability, in terms of fuel efficiency, all of that, this engine is better, and it gets even better in terms of refinement. So if you put the little bit of noise aside, we really think this is a very capable engine, and Honda has done a good job at improving the overall experience. Now, Honda says that they have made a lot of changes with the ride and handling and a lot of other things with the car, the way it drives. And this is something that we hear every single time we drive a new car. But with this one, you can actually feel the improvements. The quality overall, first and foremost, from the driver's perspective, the materials that you touch, it's definitely a step up. The finish is better. You definitely feel that you're sitting in a more evolved, a more premium car. Also, the NVH levels are much lower now. The road noise is very less. The ambient noise is much, much less than what it was before. The wind noise has been cut down. There's only the engine noise in case of the diesel engine, which can be heard prominently inside the cabin. And from that perspective, it's a great improvement over the car that it replaces. Now, the other thing is that the ride quality, with some changes made to the subframe, to the front suspension, as well as the geometry of the rear suspension, have been made. And the ride quality is significantly better. Not just is the ride quality better, it drives much better now. I like the way the steering also feels. We drove it on Nandi Hills today, and the steering felt well weighted. It felt very nice to hold, and it's not inert at dead center, which is a very nice thing to have in a mainstream car. We drove it around the twisties of Nandi Hill, and the car handled brilliantly for its class. It held its line very well. There is a bit of body roll, but then you have to have some sort of comfort also. But the body roll in all is very well contained. So there is nothing to complain about. The handling is very, very predictable. I particularly like the way the steering felt very precise and just the right weight for this segment. Gave me a lot of confidence. And if you were an enthusiast, probably in the previous gen Amaze, you would have found it a little bit wanting for grip, a little bit of poise. It was a little too soft. With this one, Honda has sorted all of that out. This one feels very nice. It rides much better. It drives much better. It handles much better around corners. And while there are cars in segments which handle better, I must add specifically the Ford Aspire, but this one also would hold its own. It's a very good balance between ride quality and handling, and I really appreciate how it drives, especially in the manual variant with the nice short throw gearbox, the nice steering, and a very well insulated cabin. So from a passenger comfort perspective, the ride quality works, and from the enthusiast's perspective, the nice steering and the very well balanced handling package really works. I really think that this job on the new Amaze has been done well by Honda, and it really handles and rides very, very well for the class. Now this engine has been redlined at 4000 RPM, and if you really push it, it's going to pass the red line by a little margin. It'll rev all the way to 4250 RPM. However, the performance is solid only till 3500 RPM. The mid-range is very, very solid, but as the taco needle starts going towards the red line, the performance somewhat starts tapering down. Alright, so we are now driving the CVT version of the new diesel Amaze, and there are a few things that you need to know before I start talking about the gearbox. First and foremost, this one is not as powerful as the manual variant. The power on this one is only 80 PS and the torque is 160 Nm. And the reason for that, as Honda told us, is to keep the transmission very smooth, make sure that there's a very flat torque curve, and make sure that the drive is jerk-free and very smooth, is what we have been told. The fuel efficiency also on this one is less than the manual variant. This one gets 23.8 kilometers to the liter, while the manual returns 27.4 kilometers. So that's something that you need to keep in mind. The power on this one is a little different from the manual variant. Now, this CVT has been introduced on a diesel by Honda anywhere in the world for the first time. This is the first Honda with a diesel and a CVT, and India is the first time for any car to have a diesel and a CVT. So how well does it drive? Well, there are three modes, as you can see here. You have drive, sport, and low ratio modes, and you obviously have the regular P, R, and N. Now D is for drive, S is for sport or slope, and L is obviously for low, Now slope or sport mode, when you put it into S from D, you will see that the revs will see a bump at any given speed or at any given throttle position, and that would mean that you have more power for any given speed or throttle position because you are at higher revs. So this transmission has a very flat torque curve, but with the increase in RPM you have more power, you are in a position to get more power, so the response from the throttle when you push it further is going to be better and your acceleration would be a bit better. So in sport mode you'll get a bit more power for any given throttle position or for any given speed when you push the throttle further. This would help you accelerate a little better, or in cases where you're going uphill or downhill, firstly the power from the engine would be better in case of uphill, and the engine braking would also be better if you're going downhill. So that's how the sport mode works. It's not meant for the enthusiasts per se, but it enhances the driving experience a little bit better, although it's not something that's going to make a significant difference in the acceleration or in terms of the way you feel while you're driving. The low mode is again like an amplified sport or slope version where you get further revs, and it's especially useful when you want to lug heavy weight or while you're going down or uphill and you need more traction and engine braking without having to increase the speed of the vehicle by itself. So that's how the three modes on this CVT work. Now, in terms of the capability of the engine to rev, this engine is not going to rev higher than 3600 RPM on the CVT variant, and the speed is not going to go above 140-150 kilometers per hour. So that's a limiting factor. As you mash the pedal, you hear a lot of noise which does not translate into a corresponding acceleration, and in that sense this CVT is essentially a CVT. This is not a step CVT, so you don't get to see any gears which are steps like on a lot of other Japanese CVTs. So you essentially in D mode you'll get to see D, and you won't have any step gears like 1, 2, 3 or 4 or 5. However, when you mash the pedal, there is that rubber band effect that you get to experience with the CVTs. The performance is a step down as compared to the manual. It's very smooth, there are no jerks whatsoever. It's a very smooth experience. You can use it on the highway, you can use it within the city as well. Very conveniently, it's going to be a great respite for the bumper to bumper traffic. However, we don't see an enthusiast driving this one, because this one, if you put it down here, this one doesn't even have a manual mode, and unlike the petrol version which comes with pedal shifters, this one doesn't even get pedal shifters. So the diesel automatic CVT is essentially a very practical, smooth kind of a system which is meant for people who want convenience more than anything else. If you're looking for performance, if you're looking to drive it enthusiastically, then the diesel CVT is not for you, since there is not even a manual mode. Also, another thing that you need to keep in mind is that the diesel CVT as well as the petrol CVT are available only on mid variants. That's your S and V variants. It's not available in the base E variant or the top of the line VX variant. It's been a long day for us. Today we are driving the four variants of the new Honda Amaze, and now we have the familiar unit, the 1.2 liter petrol, and some improvements have been made on this engine as well, although it was there in the previous version. To start off, there are lightweight components that have been used. Friction has been reduced to a large extent. The piston skirts now have a molybdenum zigzag coating in order to reduce friction as well as to stop the oil from passing the seals. You also have a few other changes made to improve the fuel efficiency primarily of the engine, and that reflects in the ARAI figures that have been achieved. So in the manual variant, the one that we are driving right now, the fuel efficiency is now 19.5 kilometers to the liter. The CVT variants is 19 kilometers to the liter. From a driving perspective, this engine remains beautiful as ever. This is a VTEC, and the qualities of this engine are unparalleled. 90 PS of power at 6000 RPM and 110 Nm of torque at 4800 RPM. Now that torque may not be class leading, there are a couple of other cars which have more torque than that one, but in terms of power delivery and the way this engine works and the way it sounds, there is no parallel to this one. In terms of drivability, you have reasonable amount of pull available from 1200 RPM to trundle along. As the needle climbs up the revs, the power builds. From 2000 RPM, you have a lot of pull with reassurance, and after 3500 RPM, this engine is on song and revs all the way to its red line of 6500 RPM. And it's a beauty to see an engine, a petrol engine which is naturally aspirated, rev to its red line. Don't we love this engine for what it is? It'll rev a little above its red line and go to 6750, and in terms of performance, there is nothing to complain about. For the class, I think this is the benchmark, and everybody else should want to create an engine which is as good as this one in terms of performance as well as fuel efficiency. In the real world, in terms of fuel efficiency, as I said, the manual version has an official figure of 19.5. On the highway, you can actually touch 16, 17, and within the city, a 13, 14 kmpl figure would not be too difficult to achieve. So a very well-rounded engine, as good as it ever was and better with better fuel efficiency, and suits very well to this segment. No complaints whatsoever. Fantastic, beautiful engine for the class. Alright, so we have driven the diesel CVT and this one here is a petrol CVT, and it is different in more ways than one. So to start off, you'd see that this one doesn't have the low mode and it only has D and S modes. Apart from that, the other change that you'd see is that unlike the diesel CVT, this one has a manual mode which is controlled through these flappy paddles behind the steering wheel. You cannot control the gears through the drive selector, but you have paddle shifters here which the diesel CVT doesn't have. So how well does this work? Well, it works just the way traditionally CVTs have been known to work. Makes a lot of noise, doesn't go as fast as you would want it to go. However, for using it within the city, there is no problem whatsoever. It's very seamless, very smooth, adds a lot of comfort to your drive if you are in a city where there's a lot of bumper to bumper traffic. However, if you mash the pedal, it's not going to enthrall you the way a manual does. And just to give you a taste of what I'm talking about, it'll make so much noise, but that would not translate into the kind of speed that you would want. Now, having said all of that, if you choose to use the manual mode wherein you choose the gears all by yourself, and if you look into the MID, in the case of the diesel, you did not have a display which showed you the gears. This one is a 7-step CVT, so you can choose from among 7 fixed ratios, and it's showing 6 right now, but it can go all the way up to 7. And the shifts come slightly delayed. It's a CVT, it's not a proper dual clutch transmission, so the shifts come slow. And if you want to like use this transmission to drive very, very fast, very enthusiastically, then obviously this is not meant for that cause. When you rev it very hard, it'll go all the way to 6000 RPM and it'll upshift, unlike the manual version where it'll go all the way to 6750. So it cuts off about 750 revs from the point where the limiter cuts in. And it's very practical, it's smooth. If you want to use it for city use or even on highway where you don't want to drive in a very enthusiastic fashion, this spells convenience, and it's good for what it's meant to be. And if you're going to whine just because it's not very quick and because it doesn't pump you with adrenaline, probably your concepts are misplaced. It's a decent CVT, and that's about it. I mean, it's practical and it's comfortable and it's relaxed, and that's that. The fuel efficiency here, however, is 19 kilometers to the liter, and the difference is only 0.5 kilometers to the liter over the manual version. And the day's job shows us about 12.5 kilometers after ripping it for quite some time. So you'll get a decent fuel efficiency as well. So how well does all of that add up? Well, with the new Amaze, Honda is offering petrol, petrol automatic, diesel, diesel automatic. But what's more important is that they are offering a 3 years unlimited kilometers warranty, which is class leading. And that really tells that they have a lot of faith in the way they have built this car. So they have built this car solid and they are giving it away with a warranty which is going to keep you trouble free for 3 full years for unlimited kilometers. Now that's something that shows that they want to capture this market. Apart from that, what they are also saying is that the service intervals on this car would be much lesser, the frequency of parts change would be much lesser, and on top of that, the prices of the parts by themselves would be much lesser, and this was demonstrated to us through a presentation. If all of that is true, we really think that this car is a fantastic buy for this segment. The space has increased, it drives fantastically, it's got good engines. The automatic transmissions may not be all that great, but they work very well in the city and on the highway for someone who doesn't want to drive enthusiastically. And as a package, we really think that this product really works for India. We still think that the front is something that we don't like much, but hey, you ordered Honda to make that and we cannot argue with that. All in all, we are impressed thoroughly with this new product. And if you're going to buy a car in this segment, don't do that before you check this one out. The prices are not out yet, but they'll be down in the description as soon as they're out. and do check them out before you make a decision. I really hope that this video was useful to you. I've tried my best to bring out whatever I could in terms of details. And if you appreciate that, do hit the like button, subscribe to Motoroids, hit that bell icon. And until next time, this is Amit Changani signing off. Rev hard, rev free, and drive safe.